because our kids, all of our kids, no matter where they come from, deserve the very best education that we can give them. And God is going to hold us responsible if we don't do it. So I'm going to be the superwoman that these kids are asking. And I'm asking all of you all to commit yourself to be a superman or a superwoman for our children.
Stand up and I'm searching for the better part of me. Yeah. I hang my head from sorrow
so much.
State of humanity.
So
wearing on my shoulders, yeah. Gotta find strength in me.
Why is that?
'Cause I am a superwoman. Yes, I'm
going to miss most about Lois DeBerry is her pleasing personality under all circumstances. I would always drop in on her during the General Assembly months, and anytime that we had business in Nashville, I'd always drop in on the speaker and say hi to her, and as much as anything, just kind of catch up on events. She was very insightful, very wise in that regard. Of course, Lois DeBerry was a lady of many talents, a lady with certainly longevity in our General Assembly, which served her quite well for the causes that she represented. She was very passionate about our justice system, civil rights, equality for women, anything that had to do with advancing her constituency. Certainly she was a worthy advocate. I grew to appreciate her more than just as a legislator, but certainly the marriage that she and Charlie Traubert had for so many years, and Charlie is such a dear friend personally. I really appreciated the partnership that they had, both their marital partnership and both of them commitment to state government, and it's all good about that. Just this past February, Lois served as our keynote speaker at our Black History Awareness Month. It was the second such event that we had had. And she just did an amazing job with giving a rousing speech about the quality of the civil rights movement, but also the work yet to be done. And I think that's the legacy that she leaves us. As public servant as great as she was, Lois will be the first to tell you that there's still much to be done. So that's our challenge with her departure, is for us to stay committed to her legacy.
To come home before the sun. And all my sisters coming together. Say yes I will. Yes I can.
Why is that?
'Cause
expressions at Lady D, Lady D meaning Speaker Pro Tem Lois DeBerry. And I really didn't know at the time what I was going to say until I stepped to the gravesite. And I simply referenced the topic of creating a novel or writing a novel. And a novel, if you will, you know, it has no content initially. You don't really reach that point of a table of content until you proceed closer to an appendix. And by that reference, I mean at the first part of a novel, you always create whatever the stage is, the middle part, you get into the meat, and as you get to the third phase of a novel, you really kind of break out the rationale. So you know when you're cheating in high school, you skim through the first part, skim through the middle part, and you get most of your meat out of the back part, and you've read the book. In saying that, referencing it to Lois DeBerry, Lois DeBerry was ahead of the scheme of things. She went straight from the first phase to the third phase. Now again, let me reference that initially the first phase is you're establishing yourself in a social hierarchy. You're trying to get your place, the corner office. You're trying to be the best you can be, the biggest pro you can be. In the middle of that book, you usually kind of reverse out. You realize what was important to you is no longer important to you. What is was. What you had, that shape is gone. And at the last part of that particular phase or novel, then you really try to find the meaning out of what you've done, and you try to extend some services or payback. Well, having said that, then Lois skipped the second and third phase. She went straight out of the first into that third phase. So immediately when she got into the legislature, she was already prepped for that mission, for the service. And having done that initially, then she became such a professional. By the time she had served 40 years, then she was good at it. She could really pick your pieces or weigh your cotton, if you will, to the point to where it didn't have her wasting time. She could put the community together, she could put a spirit together, she could just pick out what she had to do naturally. Having said that, she was not that kind of person that was selfish. And by that, I mean I have been with Lady D to so many facilities and so many programs. I walked into buildings with her where she did not tell me the facility was named after her. I've traveled with her across the nation to where I've been to programs and conferences to where she didn't explain to me that she was the president or the first black female president. Neither did I ask. We had that kind of rapport to where it was unnatural, but it was a natural sense of spirit. And by that I mean, all the time I considered that she was allowing me to walk with her, I was being taught without being taught, and at the same time not knowing that I was being taught. And saying that, meaning that if there was something that Lois requested, she had that demeanor to where you didn't question the words, because the words would come out in such a way that where you didn't have to have a definition or it didn't have to be defined. If she asked me for some funding for some entity, some project, some group she was involved in, and it was always a figure she gave me, and that was the figure, and I couldn't argue with her. I just have to say, okay, here it is. If I was with her at a dinner table and I had to pay the bill, I wouldn't argue with her. I'd just say, well, maybe next time I won't go, because I know I'm gonna have to pay the bill. But as the reciprocator, at the same time, if I had something I had to do, she would be there with the same kind of response and the same kind of funding. If she requested a bottle of some specific wine and I didn't know where it was, I'd buy all three bottles, and it was a big bottle, and I'd give it back to her, and I don't know which one it was, but the next week she introduced me to something that I'd never tasted before, and she paid the same. So whatever it was she was asking, she was always doing. Then at the same, during the last days, I often talk. I drove what I call Miss Daisy for the last 4 years going through her trials. And we talked frequently and often. The last 2 weeks I didn't talk with her. At the same time, she had somebody to call me to say those 5 minute conversations that you have with people. And when you get off the phone, you realize that they didn't really say anything. What was that about? You know, so you know they couldn't get to the extent of what the health issue was, but for some reason she had to have instructed them to say, call Tate, tell him something. And the only reason she would do that is because she couldn't do it herself. So knowing that, then I would assume that it was close to closure. We were approaching the appendix. However, you can go back with her and realize that whatever the table of content is has in it, then it was never our steps that were going to be ordered anyway. And it was some measure that we had to reach before we got to that plateau, climax, or even that particular part of death, if you want to. Having said that, then you have to realize that Lady D was aware of the fact that this was the time and the time was coming. Having said that and having walked with her, I finally realized that I was not walking with her. She was walking with me. So the end did not mean the end. There was an understanding between us that I really felt privileged that I had some kind of language or wording in the pages of her book that allowed me to be mentioned. And to be mentioned along with Lady D was quite an honor. So I have no regrets. I don't question God. I'm not sad. It was quite an honor to be in the book or the bio of Lady D. If my name is mentioned, it was her preference. As this point goes forward, then it's an honor to take what I learned with her and share it with the rest of the world at the point of her closure.
Lois DeBerry, the lady and the legacy. When I think about her legacy, I think about the lessons that she taught so many people all across this world. I think about the personal lessons that she taught me, those lessons of integrity, passion, dedication, and commitment to community. Lois DeBerry was a woman who walked among kings. She was able to represent her constituents all over this world and still comfortable going back to her church at Greater Abyssinia and being taught a Sunday school lesson. Comfortable going to the neighborhood grocery store and finding that young man looking for a job. Comfortable in bringing that young woman with a teenage baby into her fold and helping her to make her way and to raise her child. Lois DeBerry was powerful. She was effective. Her legacy will live forever. I think the lessons that she's taught me are lessons that no one could ever take from me. They're lessons of commitment, lessons of hard work, again, lessons of integrity, to be passionate and committed to whatever it is you seek to do, to always have a willing spirit to represent the least among you. When you're able to go into the boardrooms, when you're able to talk to presidents and governors, never forget that common man or that common woman that you sent there to represent. Those are the lessons that she taught. That is her legacy. It will live on and on and on. And oh, do we miss her.
When I think of the Honorable Lois DeBerry, so many words come to mind. Classy, debonair, caring, loving. I had the pleasure of meeting her at our ministry, especially when our ministry was in the growing stages. She would come with her St. John's on, and she would come with all of her splendor, but she never came across as being an arrogant or haughty individual. She always came across as being someone who cares for everybody, regardless of where they are, regardless of their race, regardless of their orientation. And I love that about her. I loved her humility and her infectious smile and laughter. I remember a time when she came back to my office. She sat on the couch and she just began to share about how this little old church inspired her and how it blessed her and how she received what she needed to receive to continue the fight for justice, the fight for equality. And I appreciate that about her, and I appreciate all of the many different visits she had to the ministry, but also the private times in which we shared. Many people don't know, but she would call me her pastor, and she said, you're my telephone pastor. And she would call me at many different hours of the night. I remember when she was gaining victory over the illness, she called me after the first time and she began to praise God and began to talk about how she was so grateful because of people like myself, as well as others, who were praying for her and believing and standing with her. And it just meant the world to me that she would think to call me after her first victory. And so I really appreciate all of those private times we've had, all of the things in which she shared, the encouragement, the support, as well as the aspect of her mentoring other people. That was major with her. Regardless of all of her accolades and accomplishments, she always took the time to mentor. Every time I saw her with somebody, she would say, "This is my mentee. This is someone who I'm training, someone who I'm helping." We were very fortunate to have several of her mentors come to this ministry, and they play an active role here in the church. And so I'm very honored to be able to share some thoughts, because words really can't describe the impact that she had on my life personally, as well as the lives of so many individuals. But we can see and we can always look at the legacy that she left, and as well as those many individuals that continue to carry the truth, as well as the stance and the ideologies that the Honorable Lois DeBerry believed in. I called her Mama DeBerry because she was just that to me. She was someone who was special and someone who I'll never, ever, ever forget.
I just think that Memphis and Shelby County cannot stand any more confusion. And I think pastors being already, the Attorney General is in a fight about a bill that they're trying to pass up here. And I just think that we are doing the people of Memphis and Shelby County disservice by passing bills up here without getting some kind of resolution from our legislative bodies in Macon and Taylor County.
But forever.